on today's show.
What in the world was that? We discuss James Harden's inexplicable disappearing act.
We make our Western Conference Finals predictions and look ahead to Game 6 in Washington.
And the ageless one, Manu Ginobili, steals the show in this week's Top 10 Plays.
It's Friday, May 12th. The starter starts now!
Good evening, Sweet World, and welcome to The Starters, presented by Jack Daniel's Tennessee Honey. Whether you're joining us live right now on NBA TV or a little bit later on YouTube, we're very, very happy to have you. I'm Jay Skeets, and alongside me, as always, that's Tass Mellis.
I'm just hearing from our producer right now. This is our one time a year that we have time to have a chat. It's going to be fun.
This will be cool. To his right, it's the international man of mystery, taking it to the max, Lee Ellis.
Friend.
Lily.
Lily, and last, certainly not least, over yonder, it is the bearded ones, Trey Kirby.
Ayo!
Ayo! TK, what do you got for us?
Well, I'm here at the internet looking for your best tweets at hashtag the starters. And guys, Kobe Bryant seems to be enjoying his retirement. He's appearing on ESPN, he's giving advice to current players, and yesterday he met one of his many muses, George R.R. Martin, the author of the A Song of Fire and Ice saga, which is, of course, it has been turned into the Game of Thrones series on HBO. And when Kobe was asked about his many muses, he went on to reveal that he'd also like to meet J.K. Rowling, saying, "I have two muse wishes," that's a thing, "talk characters and story with George R.R. Martin, and the second is to talk characters and story with J.K. Rowling." Fair enough, but it leads me to believe Kobe's planning on writing a novel at some point, so here's where you come in. Let's name Kobe Bryant's fantasy novel. Personally, I think he's gonna write three books, the Muse Cage trilogy. It'll start with The Mamba and The Master, followed, of course, by White Swan, Black Mamba, and the finale, everyone's favorite, Return of Mamba.
Right.
But we wanna hear from you, so let us know on Twitter. What would you name Kobe Bryant's fantasy novel? Send us your best tweets, hashtag the starters. We'll hear from you later.
All right, get those tweets in. We got a fun Friday show for you tonight. We got the top 10 plays from the past 7 days. And we'll look ahead to tonight's Game 6 in Washington between the Celtics and Wizards. But we start with a little true or false playoffs edition. Trey's got the questions. We hopefully have the answers. TK.
The Rockets got blasted out of the playoffs last night, losing Game 6 at home by 39 to a Spurs team missing Kawhi Leonard and Tony Parker. Big story today is James Harden, who scored just 10 points on 11 shots and didn't attempt a field goal until the second quarter. Guys, true or false? James Harden will never live this loss down.
James Harden will never live this loss down.
Never.
This cannot be true. It cannot be true. Remember when LeBron left Cleveland? Final game against Boston, that final series, he stopped shooting in game 5 before they went on to lose in 6 games. Did he live it down? I think it worked out. But at that point, right after that game, we all thought, is LeBron ever going to figure it out? James Harden hasn't figured it out. These playoffs are extremely mentally draining, and he hasn't been able to get over the hump. Something happened, whether it's with the coach or whether it's kind of like LeBron and he just thought, my teammates just aren't good enough. I'm not going to be able to figure this out. He hasn't been able to figure it out. Not everyone's a champion. 8 years into his career, James Harden hasn't figured it out quite yet.
This is going to hang over his head, though, until...
That's right.
He maybe wins a championship. I think that can be sometimes the only redemption for him, because if he went out firing last night, took 35 shots and went 10 for 35, and he's just couldn't get the ball in, you could say afterwards, he went down swinging.
Yeah.
He and you know what, if his teammates were all cold as well, you could say he at least gave it his best shot. He did not.
He did the opposite of going down swinging. He thought about throwing up a bunt, and then he's like, nah,
yeah,
too much effort.
And
it was nuts.
And you know what makes it worse? The body language was awful. There was no urgency. There was no effort. There was no embarrassment. There was no shame of like, we're getting killed out here.
Right.
I've got to, they never went on a run. They never looked at any point like, okay, this is just out of hand. We've got to do something here. And that falls, when you are the leader of the team, that falls primarily on your shoulders.
So what's the theory of why he approached Game 6 like this? Because, I mean, there's a lot flying around the internet and on Twitter and stuff like that. You got people saying the old Kobe 2006 playoff, where, for whatever reason, Kobe, in Game 7, didn't shoot in the second half against the Suns. So people are comparing that Harden to that. But, like, that doesn't make sense to me, because Kobe was making a statement. I'm not saying it was the right statement, but he had scored like 40 or 50 in the game before and they had lost, and Phil Jackson said, got to get your teammates involved. Everybody's saying, Kobe, you got to pass the ball, pass the ball. So he was like, okay, I'll pass the ball. Let's see what they can do. But Harden leads the league in assists, and no one had been saying that after, you know, the 0-for in overtime of game 5. No one was saying, oh, James Harden, he's got to get the ball to Lou Williams, well, and Eric Gordon. No one was saying that. So that doesn't...
Like LeBron in 2010, he either just said to himself, my teammates aren't good enough, or he said, I don't believe in my coach. Somewhere he just said mentally, I'm done. I mean, I'm done. We're not going to win.
But he said
I'm
that
totally
from like
done.
Minute one of this game.
And again,
yeah,
those...
He stopped. After game five, they had this. Right now, it seems extremely, extremely bleak because of that terrible game six. But they had a chance to win the series. It's 2-2. You're going into overtime. All you have to do is make a shot against the Spurs, who don't have Kawhi Leonard. Aldridge isn't playing well. And after that, it was shot. He just seemed totally out of it, and it was definitely mental. Something happened where he just said, I'm done, because it's not physical. I don't buy that for a second.
And he didn't offer that either. He didn't make any excuses,
yeah, he didn't,
to be fair to himself.
Because some people were also saying, oh, he may have got concussed late in game five, and he hasn't been the same since. Well, I don't know about you, but I heard and saw him out at the club after game six loss. Yeah. So if he really had a concussion, I can't imagine you're going out to the club. So, I don't buy that. Yeah.
But he deserves all the criticism that he is going to get for this game until we find out whatever the reason was, if there was a reason, because he had a great season, a great redemption season under Mike D'Antoni. All those players that they brought in, those teammates, it all slotted together well. They were leading this series 1-0 on the road in San Antonio. They looked great, and then it just fell apart. And there is no plausible reason why it did, other than he just stopped trying.
But right now, obviously, extremely bleak. But you look back at, like, Dirk, you know, won the MVP, lost in the first round against Golden State, that 1-8 terrible series where they won 67 games. Dirk got back on top of the world. It can happen. It just hasn't happened
but
for James Harden quite yet.
But Dirk also played his heart out in that series.
Yeah,
that's the difference.
This is the difference here. It wasn't that Harden, again, like you said, went 5 for 30, and it was one of those nights. Basketball sucks sometimes. The ball doesn't go in. It wasn't that.
What about when LeBron stopped shooting against the Celtics? He totally stopped.
And you're right. Okay, so you said.
And then he left.
So the only way for James Harden to really get this dark cloud of, you sort of blow it in the playoffs is to win a championship. I was like, he could average a quadruple double next year, and people would be like, well, you got to come through in the playoffs.
No, exactly. No,
that's what they would say.
Next season for him really doesn't count for anything. It is when he gets to the playoffs, what's going to happen then? How is he going to show he's improved and changed?
Yeah. It's tough to be a leader and to be a champion in this league. You know, it's mid-May. Some guys don't get past to this point. Some guys don't get to this James Harden point. And even fewer guys get to that June point. So, this is 5 years in Houston. After being sort of under the shadows of Kevin Durant, him and Russell Westbrook are, forever tied as guys that now are leading their teams. Will they win a championship on their own? It's a tough thing to do. It's possible, but we're in year eight. He's had 8 years. He's 28. It could still be done.
Oh, absolutely. And here's the thing, though. We're not just, I think with Harden, it's not just, where was he in overtime in game five? And where was he in the entirety of game six? And especially without Kawhi out there. This has now sort of become Harden's thing where he's had these duds in the playoffs. It started when he was still on OKC back in 2012. He shot 4 of 20 combined in games 3 and 4 of that final series, and he was a super sub for them. In the 2013 first round series against OKC, he had one really good game, otherwise he shot under 40%. It got worse the next year against the Blazers in that first round. He shot 37.6%. And then in the 2015 West Finals, He had some couple great performances, but he went 3 of 16 in game 3 and then 2 of 11 with the 12 turnovers in the closeout game 5. And then even last year, they weren't going to beat the Warriors, but Curry goes down in that game 4 and he failed to sort of seize the opportunity to take that, to maybe even up that series because they were down 2-1. He went 4 of 13 and they got absolutely crushed in the second half. And by the way, we're not even including the whole Rockets comeback against the Clippers, that miraculous 3-1 comeback where in the big game, he was on the bench. He had a horrible game. So it's not just this series. It's
a big sample size.
It's a big sample size, and I don't think until he wins a title or at least goes very, very far in the playoffs, he's going to shed it, unfortunately. That's sort of
usually
the
way it is.
He got
there. And I don't buy that it's physical that Mike D'Antoni played him too much. He played 11 games the last 29 days just because the way the schedule was worked out. I find it hard to believe that extra minutes just led him to this point where he's just flicking.
Oh, the turnovers were nuts. Yeah, sure. All right, Trey, next one.
All right, the Spurs finished the regular season with the second best record in the league. Like we're saying, they just dispatched the team with the third best record in the league pretty easily. The Golden State Warriors are 18-0 so far in the postseason while winning their games by a measly 16.5 points per game. True or false? The Warriors will sweep the Spurs.
Wow, Spurs going to get swept? No, let's falsify that one. I think we're all in agreement that they're not going to get swept, but this is the better team. They're far more rested than they were last year. I think that was a huge problem. After winning 73 games, they weren't fresh going into the postseason. They're more than fresh. And obviously,
they're healthy.
Extremely healthy, right. Across the board, from one to every super sub that they have. So it's scary. I mean, they play so evenly. You think about it, do they have a deficiency? Is there one area the Spurs are going to beat them in? I mean, they're bigger.
They got to kill them on the glass, yeah. Right? The Spurs have to kill them. But then that's the conundrum here with Pop, and we even saw it in the Rockets series, is like, do I try and just get every rebound with the two bigs out there, or can I do that against the Warriors? I imagine you can't, and that we'll probably see Jonathan Simmons, like we saw in the Rockets series,
for sure.
In terms of just one big, be it Aldridge out there or Gasol, and then pair him with like maybe a smaller four in Simmons. But
I think they start the bigs.
I don't know how you beat them.
I think they, you know, you're matching up with Zaza and Draymond. LaMarcus and Powell, I think, sir.
And obviously Kawhi's health is utmost important to the Spurs. If they're going to have any chance in this series, he has to play and he has to be healthy. The Warriors will absolutely take advantage of Kawhi not being out there, unlike what Houston did in the last series. And Kawhi, I mean, we saw it in the opening game. I know it's a long, long time ago now, that opening game of the season when they blew out the Warriors by 29. I mean, he was dominant. And we know he can defend, and we know he can be brilliant offensively. The Spurs need him to stand up and just be an absolute superstar in this series. But Warriors are at home. They're deeper. They've got the better. They've got more superstars. They're confident. They're comfortable. I mean, it's tough to see how San Antonio can actually cause the upset and win this
series. Yeah, the Warriors are playing the best basketball of their season at the right time right now, and will likely keep it going. Is there anyone else that you sort of look at on the Spurs, though, to maybe give them a chance? Like, does Aldridge have to be massive in this series? He was huge in game six.
Yeah, that's a good sign that he finished off the series with his season high of 34 points. So it's kind of miraculous that would come in game six. He said he felt more comfortable because he was the number one option. The ball was going through him and that he got a rhythm. This game is so mental. This guy obviously was signed in 2015 to be a 1A option to Kawhi Leonard. And he showed he can be that guy. But his confidence is lacking a little bit. His production in that series against the Rockets was up and down. 4, 15, 26, 16, 18, and then 34.
And if he starts warming up in this series, you know he's going to have a lot tougher job when Draymond Green comes over to him and gets right in his face and just makes him uncomfortable. It's a little different when he's playing Ryan Anderson. And even Capella's a good rim protector, but he's not the same defensive menace the Green is, so it's going to be tough for him.
Well, it sounds like everyone's leaning towards the Warriors here, which shouldn't really come as a surprise. Let's see the official predictions. Again, it's not a real predictions on the starters until you see this board. Everybody says the Warriors. Trey, Lee, Tass, like Dubs in five. Give me Warriors in six.
Yeah, I hope it goes a little longer, you know. It'd be good to see the Warriors tested a little bit.
Yeah, absolutely.
Sure, we got some time till June 1, the final start.
Number one offense, though, versus the number one defense in the playoffs. Should be good. All right, guys, got to take a break here. When we return, it's the best top 10 in sports. Yeah, you can. Welcome back to The Starters. It's a Friday staple here on the show. It's time for us to count down the top 10 plays from the past 7 days. And we start at number 10, where LeBron James, when he wasn't fake sipping beer, was showing off by using the left hand against the Raptors.
Oh, but he's left-handed.
That's right. That's
LeBron James then?
Get out, we not. Just get out.
It's almost as good as Mike Conley's offhand floater. At number 9, teamwork. Cutting, passing, and scoring. This is what the very solid play is supposed to be all about.
Yeah.
Except for the dunk.
He finished with a layup.
Yeah, exactly. That was a nice pass from Livingston. Great stuff. At number 8, Jonathan Simmons. See ya. Going down the lane. Ooh. Finishes into Houston.
Nice slice.
And that was the end of the Rockets. There was no coming back from this. Yes. What a breakout performance from Jonathan Simmons.
Trevor Ariza gets in a jam right here. Looking like the old Knicks magic, Trevor Ariza, a young buck.
Ooh.
Yeah, 13-year vet. This guy's been around.
Nice dunks in this series?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. He's played 13 years?
Yeah.
Wow. At number 6, this is a nice one from Derek Favors on Draymond Green.
Dre gets a piece of this, too.
Draymond Green, he's going to challenge everything. Yeah. But Favors just sort of bodies through him.
Yeah. Chest to chest.
Yeah, look at that. In the net.
At number 5, James goes offhand and hard in here with a right-handed jammer.
Wow. Yep. Like Jammer Jamito himself.
Oh, shout out to the Philippines. Oh, that's nice from James. At number 4, a little defense in the top 10. Thank you very much. Clint Capella.
Oh.
With the two-hand block on Murray. Get out.
Oh.
Get him Keeps on your hands right. Volleyball team.
Very volleyball-like there.
We'll take you on Team Gary.
At number 3, Kawhi, a jam on Capella. snuck it in there.
Yeah, yeah, he skips in the lane here and just pop.
It's a bit of a skip.
Yeah.
They're all step jam.
Like a Nerf Oop. Ball. No problem. At number two, it's the Wizard, John Wall.
Oh, yeah.
Off an unbelievable dime. First off, gets around Isaiah, a little spin. Woo! And then wraps it around Kelly Olynyk. Martin Gortat with a nice finish. Look at this pass.
Man, he's like doing flawless.
At number one, it's the Manu show. He had 12 points in this game, but it sure felt like a lot
nah,
more.
No, that one was worth like 20.
Yeah.
Ginobili!
Off foot with the dunk, and then overtime. Buzzer's about to go. Shot up, I'll block that.
Only Ginobili yeah. would honestly try this and, you know, perfectly execute it.
He's had two double-digit scoring games in the postseason, but it's making him count.
Harden was never the same after that one. All right, after the jump, it's do or die time in the nation's capital. We'll look ahead to tonight's Game 6 in Washington and debate whether or not the Wizards can give us a Game 7. Don't go anywhere.
The Starters on NBA TV is brought to you by Jack Daniel's Tennessee Honey, proud partner of the NBA. Do your friends proud. Please drink responsibly.
40 games and 40 nights, 40 games and 40 nights, just one tonight. Celtics and Wizards, Game 6 in D.C. Boston leading the series 3-2. Gets underway on ESPN at 8 p.m. Eastern. So don't go changing the channel. Stick here with Game Time as you get ready for this game. And we got a little look ahead. Trey, you got the cues.
Yeah, the Wizards haven't lost in Washington yet this postseason, and Game 6 tonight is in the phone booth. So what is the key for the Wizards to force a Game 7?
Maybe work up a good lather before the game. They just didn't come out and play all that well. They got caught on the offensive end way below the free throw line. The Celtics just ran it down their throat. 15 fast break points off the start. That's what it is. Get ready to play, and they played so much better at home. I do expect them to come out a heck of a lot better than what we saw to start Game 5.
Here's what they should do. They should watch Game 6 of the Spurs-Rockets game last night before they go take the court. And Brooke should say, hey, don't do that. Don't do what the Rockets did. Come out with some energy here. Don't get punched in the face first. So, yeah, they just need more energy, more hustle.
Yeah, and they've had it. They've shown that throughout the whole playoffs in the first round series as well against the Atlanta Hawks. Why they change so much when they're on the road is a real mystery, but I think they're feeling pretty good, so they're going to feel pretty good going in tonight that they can at least force Game 7.
Yeah, and in theory, they should have a good start because that's where their advantage has been throughout the entire regular season and in the playoffs. They've got one of the best starting fives in the league. Yeah. You need Wall and Beal and those guys in Morris and Gortat and Porter. Those are your best players. Those are your five best players, hands down. So they got to set the tone, I think, in this game. And I think they will because they've been great at home.
I think it'll be set by John Wall. He had a mediocre game in Game 5. Mediocre is 21 points for John Wall. But every time he's had a subpar game in this postseason, he's turned it on. He's going to have a monster tonight.
We'll see. All right, Trey, what's the flip side?
All right, every game this series has been won by the home team. So what's the key to the Celtics winning one on the road? Please say it's wearing all black.
That's what they did, arriving to the arena tonight. But maybe not give up a 20-0 run at some point as well, because that's what happened in Game 3 and 4. That 26-0 run just cost them the game in Game 4. They couldn't get back into it. So they've also got to come out with a bit more focus. And you saw Brad Stevens after that game said, if we're going to turn the ball over, let's not make it a live ball turnover so that they just go down the other end and score.
Yeah, he said we'd rather punt it into the stands. Yeah.
So at least we could set up their defense. But again, the way this series has gone, one team seems to have been able to sort of control the other team for a large portion, and that's been a big difference.
They're getting the ball out of Isaiah's hands a little bit. They're showing a second defender right behind him. So the Celtics' wings need to hit some shots. It's crazy how good they've been at home, speaking specifically of Avery Bradley and Jay Crowder, but on the road, they have been lacking. Yeah. At home, they just find their flow. You see the splits there on the bottom. It's odd. It's strange to see, but they just have more energy. It is, I think, a case of the role players finding their groove, but the groove is there to be found, the way the Wizards are playing the Celtics. Isaiah Thomas and Al Horford pick and roll. There's a guy showing, so those guys are open. You throw a couple extra hockey assists around. Can they hit shots on the road? That's the question.
Do you think the Wizards will continue with that defensive strategy in sort of trapping and all eyes on Isaiah Thomas and make those other guys beat them? That's the game.
I think that's a smart thing to do. Yeah, because Isaiah, we know he can go for 50. I'm not sure any of those other guys can do that. So
the only problem is so different for them.
Al Horford has that secondary playmaker. When you take Isaiah out of the equation, he can do it in the middle of the paint. He can find those shooters. But whether or not they can hit shots on the road remains to be
seen. We're getting to Game 7, baby. No.
Whoa. Okay. Final break. But when we return, Lee hits us with the VSP. So don't go anywhere. You're watching The Starters, presented by Jack Daniel's Tennessee Honey. Welcome back to The Starters. We asked you a fun one. Name Kobe's inevitable fantasy novel. You hit us up on Twitter, hashtag The Starters. Trey, you got a few of the best answers.
Yeah, I can't wait to read these. This one comes from Dusan, who says that it should be called Kobe's Guide to the NBA Galaxy. Not bad. Omar says Lord of the Five Rings.
Nice.
Love that. But my favorite is Bort, who says Kobe's fantasy novel, The Laker, The Witch, The Mamba. Publish it. Self-published, maybe.
For a second, I thought the title was Bort.
Bort.
I was like, what?
Abort that title.
Lee, VSP.
Yeah, it's the Houston Rockets. No, of course, it's the San Antonio Spurs here.
Good one.
It's just a classic Spurs play here. The ball just fizzes around and over to Kyle. Slow-mo in the corner with a slow-mo shot. Beautiful. I mean, the Spurs still Spurs in the playoffs.
Unbelievable.
I know.
Imagine.
You'd think they'd stop doing it. They don't. That's what I call a very solid play.
Very nice. Now it's time for the fan of the night. In Houston, there were some fans that showed up. Now, the Sporters no longer have their team this postseason, but at least they have each other, right?
Oh, true love.
Kiss Cam. Obviously, we're going to get a nice Pecorino here. Friendzone! Got him! Kissed.
Kissed around like the eyeball.
That's how friends kiss.
All right, guys, we had a blast recording the Drop podcast earlier today. It's up on iTunes, Google Play, our website. We obviously talked about Harden's Game 6. We broke down the Spurs and Warriors series in greater detail. And I asked the guys, what makes them feel alive?
Driving with the windows down, simple as that. Not too fast, not too slow. Get a good pace going. Don't have a drop top, gotta drop the windows.
Trey, what makes you feel alive?
I love to emerge from a body of water. Soaking wet, and just give my head, beard, and hair a nice shake out.
Oh, yes. We had the giggles.
Yeah, I was gonna say, that was near the end of the show. One. We definitely had the giggles. All right, just a reminder. Tonight on ESPN, Celtics Wizards Game 6. Can Washington give us a Game 7 on Sunday? We'll see. We'll be back on Monday.
Can't wait. Thank you for joining us, folks. And remember, Spurs gonna Spurs, right?
Even in the playoffs.
Even in the playoffs.
Race the weekend, people.